So I would like to talk about an issue that is not specific only to Germany, but to the US as well, and to Europe too, which is federalism. Mm-hmm. And I will start with Europe. So for the European Union, transformation and crisis have been the state of normality for a long time. But right now, I think the constellation is particularly interesting and complicated. So at the 60th anniversary of the Treaties of Rome, we see a new pro-European Union movement emerging in the capitals across the continent. You've perhaps heard about parts of Europe. And recent elections in the Netherlands and Austria point to a renewed vitality and legitimacy of the Union. But of course, at the very same moment, tensions are rising, and not only through populist movements in the West. Poland and Hungary are not only undermining their internal rule of law, but they also have successively blocked cooperation on issues, for example, of migration and refugee policy. This then has led to some previously unheard of thought experiments. So whereas until a few years ago the EU was thought of as ever expanding, we now hear fantasies of kicking out rogue members from the European Federation. Or in the words of Luxembourg's Jean Asselborn from last year, Hungary should be, I quote, excluded temporarily or forever from the EU. But what are we to make of such fantasies? Are they realistic? Are they desirable? And what do they even imply? So today I'd like to explore this issue of what I call expulsion, that is the eviction of a member state from a federal union against its will on the basis of a continuing violation of norms or obligations on several levels. Empirically speaking, can federations expel member states, and what is the constitutional status quo and its historical precedent? Then, more theoretically, what does expulsion actually mean and imply, and what does the theory of federalism tell us about it? And then, normatively, although I should say as a caveat, I'm not a normative theorist, when and how should federations have the possibility to exclude a member state? So accordingly, I will proceed in three steps. First, empirics, how do states usually deal with non-compliant members? Second, on theory, what does theory have to offer so far on this issue, especially theories of federalism? And third, on ways forward. In what way can we think about expulsion, and how does this, and this is the final step, relate to the EU? Now this is obviously a broadly conceptualized approach and rather explorative, but there's a very simple reason for it. There's a quite consistent omission of expulsion in political science. Nobody talks about it, as far as I'm aware. And if we believe the scarce literature on the issue, some kind of side remarks, there's also no historical precedent for expulsion. Now, multiple current constitutions deal with the problem of non-compliance of a member state or an ongoing rift between a federation and a single member state in various ways. One method is the regulation of secession. Now, secession is in a way the mirror image of expulsion. Here is the desire of a member state for self-determination and independence that guides the detachment from the Union. And here two varieties are possible. On the one hand, unilateral secession, or on the other hand, secession with the agreement of the federal center or the remaining member states. Now, currently in the constitutions of Ethiopia, St. Kitts and Nevis, and the recently independent South Sudan, we find explicit provisions that allow for secession. Here's, for example, Article 39 of the Ethiopian Constitution, outlining the process quite elaborately. So Section 4 says the right to self-determination, including secession of every nation, nationality, and people, shall come into effect and then follow a number of conditions, such as parliamentary approval, a referendum, and then further steps for procedural accuracy. There have been multiple historical instances of a member breaking off from a federation through secession. Think of the various secessions from the Soviet Union in the early 90s, accelerating and ultimately leading to the collapse of the USSR. But interestingly, many countries that have themselves experienced secession in one way or another seem to be open to allowing its own federal units to possibly secede. I've mentioned Ethiopia, which introduced its new constitution a year after Eritrea's independence, which had succeeded a civil war, but also South Sudan, itself a product of secession as recently as 2011, decided to allow further secession under certain conditions in its own constitution. Now, these secession clauses are exceptions from the rule. Most countries do not allow for secession, or they even expressly forbid it. Now, how do these federations then deal with internal tensions, non-compliance? In many of these constitutions that openly prohibit or omit secession, we will find sanctioning mechanisms. The procedure is usually the following. If a member state violates some federal rules or neglects obligations in a grave and persistent manner, the federal government or the remaining member states deciding in unison can impose sanctions on the states or temporarily take over some of its functions. There are various examples for this, for example, India or Switzerland. I would like to highlight the example of the German Basic Law, Article 37, which not many people who are not lawyers know, and which is building on a similar clause in the federal system of the German Reich. It is in German called Bundeszwang, in English federal execution. If a land fails to comply with its obligations under the Basic Law or other federal laws, the federal government, with the consent of the Bundesrat, so the other executives of the other Länder, may take the necessary steps to compel the land to comply with its duties. This is vague and it has never been activated. And there's very scarce juridical literature on it. So this provision relies on an ultimately technocratic approach to federal internal tensions. If a member state refuses to comply with norms and obligations, it will be coerced to do so in the future. So while this article, as I said, has never been activated, Article 7 in the Treaty of the European Union seems much more relevant today, and I will talk about that more later. Suffice it to say for now that the implied procedure is similar. If a member state persistently violates core norms and rules, the EU has some sanctions at its disposal to exert pressure on the state, but within certain very closely circumscribed limits. So in sum, the two mechanisms related to member state non-compliance and what one could call membership flexibility can be encountered in today's constitutional world are secession and sanctions, but both stop decidedly short of expelling a member state. Secession, on the one hand, would, as expulsion, result in a member's detachment from the Union, but in contrast to secession, expulsion would emanate from the center or the remaining member states without the agreement of the member state in question. On the other hand, sanctioning mechanisms work as a measure to avoid secession or expulsion by incentivizing or forcing the member back into the Union as a fully functioning member. What, however, happens if that attempt, these attempts were to fail is not codified in any of these constitutions. That brings me to my second point, theories of federalism. Now, in political theory and theories of federalism, in particular, expulsion is a largely ignored issue, as I've said. So in the few instances where it is mentioned, it's in passing without systematic analysis. And I think it's telling that there's not even an agreed upon term for the phenomenon. So we find various names, not just expulsion, but exclusion, eviction, separation, and so on. Now, it seems at first glance perhaps plausible that political science or constitutional theory would not engage too much with a dynamic that is historically and currently without example. But I think one could argue, on the contrary, that political theory is in fact especially suited to reflect on constellations that have not happened yet. There are libraries full of books on global democracy, world federation, and political philosophy, or on other unrealistic options for bold constitutional reform and renewal. The oversight then seems especially surprising because structurally the mechanism should have a place in the grammar of how political systems and especially federations work, even if the event has no historical precedent and even if it's not a desirable event. So what do I mean by grammar? If we consider other key concepts in political theory, especially in describing regime types and types of political order, research in the past decades has brought about descriptive and structuring toolkits typologies in terms of spatial, economic, social, and temporal criteria. So the temporal dynamic criteria is, for example, in the studies of empires, which is one field I'm familiar with, encapsulated in schematics of rise, decline, and fall. And in the study of nation states, in terms of state formation or integration, disintegration, state failure, etc. And these are thought of as possible, though not teleological, answers to the question, how does a political order form, develop, evolve, create cohesion, perhaps dissolve, etc. The understanding of federations as a specific variant of political order containing, to give you like a very minimal definition, containing at least two territorially distinct levels of government, would lend itself to a similarly grammatical approach, I think, to comprehensively describe how federations might form, evolve, change, or cease to exist, in short, what the different possible federal configurations are. So far, in theories of federalism, much attention is paid to the formation, enlargement, and secession from federations. For example, and these are only three select, though I think formative and representative examples, Karl Joachim Friedrich has, in his extensive work on federalism as process, looked at territorial adjustment, the accession of new member states, and at secession. He's interested in the obviously possible constellations of federalism on the development of federalism, especially with regard to territorial, to the territorial shape. But he does not say a word about expulsion or forms of detachment other than secession. William Riker, the author of perhaps the most famous unified and decidedly non-normative theory of federalism, has focused on the formation and execution of federalism out of conflict-ridden conditions or constellations, but again, nothing on expulsion. And Daniel Elazar, a scholar with a large oeuvre of very emphatic arguments, very normative arguments for federalism, has insisted that federations as covenants, as he calls it, should be permanent as organic, basically sacred unions. He thinks of complete breakup as the worst case scenario, but does not think of kind of gradual dissolution or detachment as a measure of flexibility. So why then does expulsion as a constellation not figure in these works? And why is there no hypothetical or provisionary reflection, not even thought experimentation on the issue? The answer, of course, has to remain speculative and always depends on the author in question. But I think there are some shared assumptions that lead to the omission of expulsion. And one hint is, I believe, to be found in the works of Daniel Elazar. In his classic Exploring Federalism of 1987, he discusses the case of Singapore's detachment from Malaysia in 1965, the dissolution of a short-lived and rather unhappy federal union in a post-colonial constellation. It is for him an example of secession. What in fact happened in 1965, however, at least according to a variety of historical documents, was that the Malaysian government worked to expel Singapore from the federation. Lacking any procedure for membership flexibility, the government decided to pressure the Singapore government within the time span of 1 or 2 days into signing an agreement that feigned voluntariness, all in the beginning of 1965. And subsequently, the Prime Minister of Singapore declared Singapore's independence under tears. The treatment of the case of Singapore, not just by Elazar, so the decision to ignore expulsion, if we might actually be looking at a case of forced exclusion from a federation, even if it's behind a facade of agreement and voluntariness, hints at one possible reason for why political theory does not consider expulsion. It's simply normatively undesirable in the sense that it runs against the dominant forms and languages guiding especially the study of federalism. Federations are generally thought of as voluntary, egalitarian, and free. It is the norms of group rights, collective self-determination, subsidiarity, and diversity that dominate the debate. Norms that resonate with the much theorized option of secession, but of course stand in stark contrast with the scenario of expulsion. In the latter, different norms are at play. Stability, the maintenance of a set of, let's say, identity-building norms in the overall federation, values of the overall federation. This specific type of normativism in current federal theory, I believe, motivates its reservations against scenarios of expulsion. The paradoxical effect, however, is that it hinders other potentially also important normative considerations. Imagine a case where a federal member state decides to discriminate against or even persecute an ethnic minority in contradiction to federal constitutional framework and stops paying contributions to the federation's social welfare system. Imagine further that this member cannot be moved to change its policy through fines and sanctions, but it also refuses to voluntarily leave the union. In all federal constitutions at the moment, the only way forward would be to let the member state pursue its course, let it, in this case, undermine the welfare system and the normative framework of the union, thus endangering collective goods far transcending its own borders. Because of a lack of procedures for expulsion, the only alternative to this permissive course would be an extra constitutional and even violent severing of federal ties on the part of the center or the remaining states through civil war or an overall collapse of the federal union. This then, I think, adds another reason for why political theory should at least consider expulsion, besides the argument of this grammatical comprehensiveness, that is, the argument of normative implications. If there are cases, even if there are very few, where expulsion might just theoretically be a beneficial option for a federation, political theory could contribute to develop a plausible framework for evaluating this, highlighting implications and pitfalls. Again, theorists should also think about phenomena that have never happened before, and even if, or especially if, they seem so evidently undesirable. This then brings me to my third point. So far I've tried to show in what manner and why expulsion has not gained much attention and why it would be advisable to close this gap of reflection. Now, it's obviously not my goal today to offer a full-fledged theory of expulsion, because it should have become clear by now that this issue is a sensitive one, it's politically risky territory that cannot be tackled casually. But it requires basically the cooperation and reflection of political scientists, constitutional theorists, and political actors ultimately. What I'd like to do instead as a starting point is introduce a couple of, let's say, theoretical guideposts. So when theorizing expulsion, what should we watch out for? And in a last step, I will, as I said, try and apply this to the European Union. Now, one way to think about under-theorized phenomena is through analogy. But I think when it comes to federalism, analogies can be misleading and often have been. Take the most common one. Marriage. Yeah. It has become somewhat customary to compare federalism to marriage, presenting both as a unity of equal but different entities. Accordingly, one famous book on secession by Alan Buchanan is called The Morality of Political Divorce. And think about the recent discussions about Brexit, where even in the German Tagesschau, the headline would be Scheidung, divorce between the EU and Great Britain. Federalism is not a union of individuals, but of collectives. And they are usually not bound by love, but by other factors. They don't procreate, etc. So even if it may be tempting to make expulsion easier to grasp by comparing it to an orderly divorce proceeding, it ignores the genuinely political nature of the federal relationship, I think. Instead, I believe we need to systematically explore expulsion as a phenomenon of federalism. Which dimensions must be considered in evaluating federal expulsion and which mistakes avoided? I'd like to very briefly point out four aspects to keep in mind. First, the conceptual layer. Here we need to ask, what are federations? What are their forces of cohesion, generally, and in their different subtypes? And what does that mean for expulsion, its plausibility, and its possible advantages and pitfalls? If, for example, we see federations as political units with a specific mode for conflict resolution and the pursuit of shared interests. Federal cohesion will crumble if conflicts are not resolved but heightened, and if interests are not furthered but undermined by the Federal Union. That just as one conceptual possibility. In such a context, membership changes can potentially prevent more conflicts or retain benefits for remaining members. When it comes to the question what a federation is and how it functions, what functions it serves, another possible analogy that does not work could be interesting, I think, and could caution against treating expulsion too lightly. So if international organizations, such as the UN, for example, rather easily permit both secession and expulsion, as is the case, why should it be a big deal in federations? This goes, I think, to the core of how one could conceptualize federalism. Federations are not loose alliances or economic treaties, but political orders in which different units form a political whole. So belonging or not belonging to a federation decides over the political status of the member and the rest of the union. It's decisive for the political status and identity, making it a particularly deep change, which explains, for example, the overall reluctance of federal political actors to even consider expulsion, and which again recommends a very careful consideration of all implications. So this was the conceptual point. Second, and relatedly, on the feasibility of expulsion. How can we determine in which constellations expulsion could and should be an option? There are obviously a few aspects to this problem, one of which is, are the two entities separable? Or are they too institutionally or otherwise entangled? And do the member states in question possess a sufficiently high degree of autonomy and also distinct identity, perhaps, to form self-contained policies after the process of detachment? In federations that are very tightly integrated, or where the member states are too small or underdeveloped for an independent existence, expulsion might just be normatively so problematic that it might not be an option. And in that case, again, stabilizing measures would have to be limited to devolution or sanctions rather than membership flexibility. Furthermore, is expulsion compatible at all with the constitutional principles? So not the positive law, but the constitutional spirit and the attitudes among elites and population in a given context, what German federalism scholar Jörg Borschek has called the ideational layer of federalism. To highlight one aspect here, most constitutions, including federal constitutions, emphasize that the political order is intended to be permanent, if not eternal. While many federations, such as the EU, but also the US, aspire to grow, at least in some historical phases, very few aspire to shrink or dissolve. What, however, distinguishes some federations or some states from others is the price its elites or its population are willing to pay for stability, for permanence, and what the stability or permanence actually entails. So, should the territorial extent of a federation be kept constant at all costs, not getting rid of a member state no matter how it interacts with the union, so pursuing an organic notion of federal stability with regard to the territory and the populations? Or, by contrast, is the federation understood as a project for certain norms and values, a union only open to members adhering to this project? Third, the role of process in expulsion. What requirements are there procedurally to ensure that a fail-safe mechanism of expulsion actually stands a chance of fulfilling its goal, that is to resolve a conflict where all else fails and to prevent more widespread escalation and disarray? Here we can in fact learn from the literature on secession, I think, because the very same question of procedural detail is at play here. It concerns the constitutional design of an expulsion clause. Remember the secession clause I showed from the Ethiopian constitution? So constitutional language can formulate conditions, but also timelines and institutional stages and thresholds to make the process an orderly and predictable one. Important aspects could be to sanction only sustained and long-term non-compliance and to ensure that the decision process is not a centralist one. say, the executive in the federal center against one state, but rather that all the remaining member states find a legitimate consensus on the future of the federation. This would then help ensure that the expulsion process itself does not create further chaos. Ultimately, if the expulsion option seems realistic and feasible, one could think, this might actually help as a deterrent to rein in the non-compliant behavior that started the conflict in the first place. And this, as a very brief fourth point, this deterrent effect touches upon a fourth aspect, collective psychology. What would the introduction of an expulsion clause do to the cooperative balance in a federation? As a stabilizing incentive, as a deterrent, or perhaps as a destructive factor in the establishment of mutual trust? Much more could be said about this, but I'm not an expert in game theory or collective psychology, but a theorization of expulsion could consider this as a layer as well. Now, finally, how do these four rudimentary guideposts, conception, feasibility, process, psychology, relate to the situation of the EU outlined initially? Now, the EU seems to undergo a federal challenge, more or less, as I've described it so far. The Polish and Hungarian governments are backtracking on their internal rule of law and democratic legitimacy, thus coming into conflict with Article 2 of the Treaty of the European Union on the Union's value framework, which includes values of respect for human dignity, freedom, democracy, equality, the rule of law, and respect for human rights, including the rights of persons belonging to minorities. In addition, their willingness to cooperate towards common solutions for shared problems, as in the area of refugee agreements, is in sharp decline. And unlike Britain, the states concerned are not seeking to take back control through unilateral exit, that is, secession. So Article 7 of the Treaty of the European Union regulates sanctions in case of a serious and persistent breach of values as described in Article 2, to be activated by an unanimous decision in the Council and consent by the European Parliament. Beyond Article 7, however, there is no provision for the event of a country's permanent and unrepentant violation of community values. The same limitation applies to the violations of other policy and legal instruments, so beyond the core value framework question of the community. So a member repeatedly blocking initiatives or challenging EU regulations can only be fined, as is currently not expelled. So is the EU then possibly a candidate for an expulsion clause? And now this is really only thought experimentation. The constellation seems to relate to some of the guideposts mentioned so far, I'd say. The EU seems not indissoluble, as we're seeing right now, or will see. But more importantly, it appears that the EU is a political project aiming at stability through a certain degree of flexibility, where it's imperative that certain norms and principles are upheld without insisting on a static territorial extent. So I would say that the EU does not pursue a notion of organic territorial unity. The whole layout, the spirit of the EU, is one of a norm-based project that would not try and preserve its membership extent at any cost, say, constant violations of democratic norms or the rule of law. Procedurally, Article 7 in principle contains a sound procedure not just for sanctions, but for expulsion perhaps as well, as it attributes the right to decide to the remaining members instead of a central governmental unit. But it also illustrates an important difficulty. An expulsion clause similar to a sanction clause must include a high but not impossible threshold for activation. And the recent conflict with Poland indicates that even the threshold for sanctions, for the sanction articles triggering, might be too high. It might actually be an option to transfer the decision about sanctions, as it might be possible to use it for expulsion, to the increasingly important European Parliament. Mm. Then the psychological factor of deterrence might also be more effective. Furthermore, regarding the challenge of ensuring a well-structured, non-chaotic process of disentanglement, the EU's experience with Article 50 in the case of Brexit could prove instructive, I think. if such a drastic last resort option as secession or expulsion is made available at all, and if the opportunity to remodel the EU treaty framework were ever to arise, and I actually don't find this all that unlikely, the provisions must be practicable once triggered. It would certainly defeat the benefits of an expulsion clause if it created additional unnecessary confusion, as we see it between London and Brussels. So where does this leave us? As I try to show, the issue of expulsion raises crucial issues of political cooperation and stability. At stake is, among other things, the question, what is the priority, what the normative framework guiding the political system and its decision makers? Is it collective self-determination? Is it some idea of organic unity or fixed territorial extent? Or is it the upholding of values like rule of law or democracy? This certainly does not only concern the EU, I think. Constitutions are constantly reformed or overturned, even if we might not think about constitutions that way usually. They're newly redesigned constantly around the globe, many of them in fact as federations. Think of Iraq, think of the failed attempt to redesign the Yemen constitution recently. Mm-hmm. And instead of copying existing constitutional frameworks with all their traditions and limitations, constitution writers might be well advised to just go for one second go back to some rather basic questions such as what is the goal of a certain specific political system that they're designing and what are the means to provide to achieve this goal. So thank you very much for your attention and I look forward to some questions because this is also a very new project of mine. So,
thank you.